Hallelujah. Come on, let's just lift your hands. Open your heart to Jesus this morning. Come on, everybody, get off your seat. Get out your bed. Give honor and glory to the God who woke you up this morning. Hallelujah. He woke you because it was important for you to be alive. So be honorable today. Surrender to his presence. Give him the glory. Do his name. In Jesus' name, amen. If you're around anybody, give them a hug or a handshake, and you may be seated. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Amen and amen. Woo. Well, I'm so glad you guys decided to join us today. I believe God's going to be faithful to us and speak to us like he always does. But let's do our confession. Say this with me. Say, my heart is good ground. I can receive the word of God, and it's going to bring forth a hundredfold return in Jesus' name for my good and God's glory. Hallelujah. You know, God gave me a message that I want to share with you. And it's the deliverer is in the ark. Deliverance is in the ark. I wrote it different. The deliverer is in the ark. Therefore, deliverance is in the ark. So we're going to be talking about being safe. You know, salvation means that you have been preserved from the coming judgment of God. Now, we're in the world, and there's a lot of things going on in the world. Jesus says there's going to be wars, pestilences, earthquakes in diverse places, you know, rumors of wars. And he says this, very important. He says, be not troubled, for these things must come to pass, but the end is not yet. He said, but when you see these things, look up, because your redemption is drawing nigh. You know, going home is, we're getting closer to going home. But Jesus did say the sign of the end of the world. He said, when they say peace, peace, then sudden destruction. Not saying that we should not strive for world peace, but that will be the sign of the coming of Jesus, which means the end of the world. All right. Well, because the world's not going to look for peace in God. They're going to look for peace in however they decide to do it. But go real quick. We're going to talk about being safe. And I wrote a bunch of things, but I want you to go real quick to John chapter 8, verse, I believe it was 35, started verse 34, John chapter 8, verse 34. Jesus answered him, verily I say unto you, whosoever committeth sin is the servant of sin. And the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth forever. Verse 36, if the son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. And so I want to talk to us today, you know, from the position of being saved, being safe in the ark that God has provided. You know, if we leave the ark, we're going to get into sin. I was thinking about people getting challenged. You know, they get a rough situation in their lives and they run. Never develop the strength that comes from staying. You know, an oak tree gains strength no matter what goes on. It bears down its roots. You know, it's like the palm tree. You can sway a palm tree. There's hurricanes, tornadoes. But you ever notice those palm trees stay? Because they have developed a root system that goes down to where life is. See, as a believer, our life is in our trials. Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, he said, persecution, well, scripture says persecutions will abide you. In other words, you're going to run into persecutions. They're not there to destroy you, they're there to strengthen you. But when you run from the persecution, you never develop strength. And I've noticed that even people, Christians, I don't want to say people because I don't think Jewish people do it, Muslims do it, Buddhists do it. I don't think they do it, Hindus do it. But Christians, the moment they get in trouble, they'll leave their church like that. It's like they go pull up their little dresses and run, and they go to the next church. Soon as trouble or persecution or a challenge comes, they pull their little dresses up and they run. But you never see that as a testimony in the Jewish community, Islam, the Buddhists. You never see them running from trouble. They endure hardness, whereas the believer is supposed to endure hardness as a good soldier. And so I want to talk to us about staying in the ark. It's a place of safety. And Jesus said here, whosoever committed sin is the servant of sin, and the servant abideth not in the house forever, but the son abideth forever. See, as a we're God's children, but we still serve him. So we can be considered servants of God. We used to be servants of sin. Now, the bad thing is when a servant of God start to be a servant of sin, meaning you stop obeying God's word and you start doing things to satisfy what you feel comfortable in, you pretty much leave being a child of God to just now being a servant. And now a servant doesn't abide in the house forever. Case in point, if you hired people to tend to your house and you have children, at night they will punch out and they will go, the servants will punch out and go to their home where the children will stay in the house. So we have to get back into obeying God, no matter how hard it is. Obey God so you can abide as a child of God in the house forever. Amen. And so we're going to look at the ark, throughout the Bible, and we're going to get to a place where we can rest, knowing that we're abiding in him. And so let me just give you this definition. To abide literally means to stay. It can be used for the word living, remain, or continue. Jesus says, abide in me. He's actually saying, stay in me, live in me, remain in me, continue in me. But many times as believers, we go in and we go out. And as we look at today's message, I didn't write it, but I will find a note here. There's possibly three types of Christians. There's the Christian that takes the word of God literally, right? And then there's a Christian that takes the word of God passively, And then there's a Christian that meshes them both and takes the word of God and applies it in a balanced way to their lives. And when you're reading the scriptures, you get challenged to be both. Paul, he said, if you get saved and you're not married, he says, don't get married. He said, but if you're saved and you are married, stay married. He said, I wish you could abide as me. So if you are a believer and you take that literally, you will not get married. But if you are, a nominal believer, he's like, well, Paul, I'm getting married. I'm going to do my thing. And none of it is sin. But the reason why I'm saying this is because you got to get to a place where you know where you are in the things of God. Or you can be the balanced Christian and say, you know what, Paul? I hear you. I'm going to live like this. And this is the balanced Christian's life. You ready? Somebody say, I'm ready. The balanced Christian says this, you know, I plan for tomorrow, but I live like Jesus is coming back today. Come on. See, the balanced Christian says, I plan for tomorrow, but I live like Jesus is coming back today. You know, so many people spend so much of their time in sin. Now, let me tell you what I mean by sin. Sin meaning missing the mark. If God tells you to do something and you don't do it, you have missed the mark. You have sinned. You're not going to go to hell, but you're not going to have God's best operating in your life. And that's in most of our lives. There's a time when we decide to do what we want to do, you know, and sometimes we don't always know that it's God's will, you know. And I wrote this before we look at the first arc. Jesus says this in Luke 17:27. They did eat, they drank, they married wives, they were given in marriage until the day that Noah entered into the ark and the flood came and destroyed them all. So in other words, you need to live. Jesus will come back at the right time. Get married, have children, go to school, get a job, eat your chicken, live your life, come on, and live holy. This world is not supposed to stop. It's supposed to keep going. Jesus will come back at the right time and you will be ready. So enjoying this life isn't sin. It's not being ready for the return of Jesus. Now that's sin. You know, and so many times people struggle because they want more out of life. You know, it's nothing wrong with wanting more out of life, but you know, Jesus, the Lord, he says, what if you gain the whole world and lose your soul? What shall it profit you? So you need to be that balanced Christian that knows, listen, I'm going to plan for tomorrow, but I'm going to live like Jesus is coming back today. Can you say amen? Say amen a little louder. And so, you know, God really, really began to, you know, work in me something that I want to say that I'm living by. And it's the fact that God doesn't change. He's held every generation down. That's an inner city vernacular, you know, hold it down. You know, you're going to hold me down? Yeah. God held every generation down. Not one generation was lost. He kept every generation alive. And I wrote some things about him. Let's look. Why? God forgive me for saying it. I'm going to read some verses of scripture about him, about God. Psalm 100, verse 5 says this, for the Lord is good, his mercy is everlasting, and his truth endureth to all generations. Psalm 90, verse 2, 1 and 2, Psalm 90, 1 and 2. Lord, thou hast been our dwelling place in all generations. Before the mountains were brought forth, forever thou hast formed the earth and the world. Even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. See, we need to, forgive me, this is, you know, I learned this from Dr. Cheryl Harley. You know, you salute up. You salute up when someone higher than you come, you know, in the army, they do a salute. But in the kingdom, we do a bow. It's always good to worship God. It's always good. You know, they got this thing in the NFL, they take a knee. You know what? We take two knees all the time. Hallelujah. Maybe they should do that. Somebody should do two knees and lift their hands. Come on, you can start a revival. Start a revival in the NFL. You know, have people different melanin at the beginning of the game go down on their knees and lift their hands. It'll catch on because God is blessing America to be a Christian nation. And most men watch football. So if you get some strong Christian men, bow their knees, lift their hands toward heaven before the football game, it'll catch on. We'll have a revival. Hallelujah. That's right. Buy your tickets. Do it in the NBA, NHL, anywhere. Because they always, remember they used to have to sign up John 3:16? Show them. All right. So you see that, right? Before the mountains were brought forth forever, thou hast formed the earth and the world, even from everlasting to everlasting, thou art God. It's very vital and important that you understand that God wants to preserve you, bless you, provide for you, prosper you. And he doesn't change. Psalm 119 verse 90 says this, thy faithfulness is unto all generations. Thou hast established the earth and it abideth. The earth is not going anywhere. Not until God says so. He made it and it's abiding. And you know what? If people want to try to destroy the earth, they'll die first. People have a certain time period, you know. All right. But I just wanted to show you that so that we can be on one accord knowing that God is our preserver. God is our Savior. God is our King. Go to Jeremiah chapter 29, verse 7. Because all of us, every single one of us, have been challenged sometime in life. You wake up one morning and you look at your spouse, and sometimes you say, praise God, and other times you're like, what did I do here? Nah, just joking. Or you wake up in the morning and you have children, you be like, where did these kids come from? They're nothing like me. You know. Or you wake up one morning and you see your mom, your dad, and they're acting like how they act. You be like, how did I get in this family? You know? So there's challenges in every aspect of our lives. You know, but in Jeremiah 29, verse 7, the Lord says this. And I want you to receive this. And I want you to do this. And he says this. And seek the peace of the city whither I have caused you to be carried away captives, and pray unto the Lord for it. For in the peace thereof shall ye have peace. Come on. For in the peace thereof shall ye have peace. God says this. I'm just going to paraphrase. No matter where you are, pray for it. Don't pray against it. Don't pray against your spouse. Don't pray against your children. Don't pray against your parents. Don't pray against your job. Don't pray against your city. Don't pray against your government. Don't pray against your nation. Pray for it. Pray for the peace of it, right? He says this, for in the peace thereof, ye shall have peace. Every one of us are living in situations that we might not think we have control over, but if we're in God, God has control over it. And if we're in God, we pray to God who has control over it to give us peace in it. And once we have peace, we have control. Peace is likened unto nothing missing, nothing broken, no disruption, you know, nothing out of order. So when you have things in your life that are not right, pray for the peace of it. You saw that, right? Amen. So now let's look at, you know, an ark. So we're talking about God preserving us, and the definition of an ark, and this is interesting how the Bible used it. An ark is a chest or an encased box to store or save things in. It's an encased box to store or save things in. So whenever, you know, you have valuables, you know, you ever go to the bank and you take your jewelry or your certain articles that you don't want left in the house, you put them in a safe, and the safe is a box, a chest that was created to keep things that are valuable safe. And that's what the ark is. The ark is a box designed to keep that which is valuable safe. And so the first ark we see in Genesis chapter 7, verse 1, was Noah's ark. And the Lord said unto Noah, come down, and all thy house into the ark, for thee have I seen righteous before me in this generation. You know, God was going to destroy all living on the earth, but he wanted to preserve Noah. So he told Noah, get in the safe, get in the ark, right? And remember where we're going with this. The deliverer is in the ark. Therefore, deliverance is in the ark. So when God wanted to save Noah, he made Noah a deliverer by building the ark, right? Noah, his name actually means rest. Come on. So even you and I in the church is the ark because it's the body of Christ. We're saved in Christ. We're saved in the ark. And that's why it's challenging for people to stay committed to their local church because they don't know how God sees it. You know, if you can't build your local church, then you made a breach in the wall. That's where you and I are supposed to build. If we stop building, right there is where the breach is. And God sees it, Satan sees it, and that's where the attacks come when people stop building their local church. How do you build your local church? You be the most important member there. You be the best giver. You be the best prayer person, you to be the best teacher, you to be the best person that teaches how to love. That's how your church grows. Your church doesn't grow by you just showing up to services. Your church grows by, the Bible says this, every joint compacted, fitly together, supplies the edifying of itself in love. As you stay close to the members of your church grows. You stay away from them, your church diminishes, the attacks come, and who's going to be blamed? Them that left the ark. That's with all of us. Amen. You don't want to be blamed because you're happy. All right, let's keep going. You know, it's like those fathers that run out on their children, you know, and they go get a new wife. You know, you're going to pay for that. All right. Or a wife goes out on her husband. You're going to pay for that. Let's keep going. So, you know, let me show you this, what it says about Noah. Genesis 5:29. And he called it when he was born, and he called his name Noah, saying, this same shall comfort us concerning our work and toil of our hands, because of the ground which the Lord has cursed. In other words, the ground was cursed, you know, because of the sin and Adam and Eve, and they prophetically saw Noah as the change. And that's why they named him Noah, and it said, this same shall comfort us concerning our work and toil of our hands. And like I said earlier, the name Noah actually means rest. Now, what's interesting, it's 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 20. And some people take this to mean that water, baptism, saves you. Now, Peter says water baptism is the answer of a good conscience toward God. But I look at this, and I wrote something, and I'm not saying that this, what I'm going to say, is the greatest revelation or the right revelation, but it's a revelation. Now, all revelations can change, right? Because the only thing that remains is truth. So go to 1 Peter chapter 3. 1 Peter 3:20 says this, talking about Noah, talking about the people during the time of Noah. He said, "Which sometime were disobedient, when once the long suffering of Noah, which sometime were disobedient, when once the long suffering of God waited in the days of Noah while the ark was a preparing, wherein few, that is 8 souls, were saved by water." 8 souls were saved by water. Now, you can read that and think that the water saved them. And I have a thought that I got concerning the water saving them. It has nothing to do with baptism. Watch this. The water saved them by killing their enemies. The water came to destroy all the wicked people on the earth, therefore protecting Noah and his families from the enemy. I saw that, you know. So the water killed their enemy, right? But the ark in the water was a preserver, the chest. See? Noah's ark preserved life, and the water saved them by killing their enemies. You know, as a human being, you know, we love people, but people can become your enemy. God told the children of Israel, when you go into the promised land, he said, kill them. Kill every one of them. Because if you don't, they're going to infest you. They're going to bring their lifestyle into your life, and you're going to accept it, and I'm going to have to destroy you. See, people don't understand what sin does. Sin is actually the devil. Sin is Satan manifesting himself in your life. So when God wants to eradicate sin, he's really eradicating the devil. But if you love the devil and you love sin, he has to eradicate you as well. That's what makes it difficult for people to differentiate pleasure from sin. The Bible says concerning Moses, he said he forsook the pleasures of sin for a season. You know, sin has pleasure. There's pleasure in sin. But when you become holy, you begin to recognize this pleasure. I'm not pleasing God. I'm actually pleasing the devil, who is making me think that I'm enjoying this. So when you're in sin and you don't accept God for being righteous, you're going to please the devil, and God's going to actually have to come and judge you and I for that. You know, it's unfortunate. You know, we want to be happy, and being happy doesn't mean that you're right with God. Amen? So that's how God showed me that. You know, they got saved through the water by the enemy being killed, not them. Well, now look at this. We're going to go real quick because we only got a little more time left. In Exodus chapter 2, verse 3, you know, it says this concerning Moses when he was born. And when she talking about Moses' mother, because she hid him, because think of it this way. I want you to see this. We're in troubled times, but we're nowhere near the time of Moses nor the time of Jesus. During the time of the birth of Moses, they were killing all male children. You know, of course, there's some nations that still, you know, seek to kill innocent babies. You know, some people have no problem killing babies too. You know, but here, the king, the ruling power, says kill these. You know, if they have a boy, kill them. And during the time of Jesus, you know, Jesus was born. The wise men came to Herod, you know, never went back. So Herod said, go kill every child, you know, up to 2 years old. So imagine, you know, being in a society where the leaders, the governments, are out to kill your children. That's horrible. So we need to really thank God the time we're in. Amen? So look at this. So verse 3, Exodus 2. What we're talking about today is the faith to stay in the ark. You have to stay in the ark. Wherever God plants you, that's where you grow. You get out. You know, I was thinking about, I never left my church. My pastor has been my pastor, I don't know, since 1986. Never, ever in my life have I ever thought about going to another church. Why? Because I got saved there. When you get saved somewhere, and I got delivered there. Come on, I received love there. I received correction there. I received direction there. So it never, ever dawned on me not to be there. You know, but you got some people that, you know, they feel as if the Lord moved them on. You know, if the Lord moved you on, then move on. You know, but it's going to, you know, I always think about it like this. If you've been in a church long enough, you should have developed a root system where you should leave and become a minister, a servant. So if you leave one church to go to another, you should go and tell them, I'm somebody, and you need to put me in position and see how that works for you. All right. Yeah, because I don't think hopping from church to church is scriptural. It's not scriptural. It's something that, you know, Christians and, you know, especially in America, they have adopted. You know, being faithful and loyal, it's not the American way. Sound like the thing for Superman. All right, here we go. So, verse 3, you know, it's important. You know, if you're going to be, you know, on your job, you know, some people leave jobs and they get better jobs and more money or whatever because, you know, that's how they like to advance. You know, I've come from a generation where we stay and we grow. You know, this you know who you are, however you operate, but there's safety in longevity. You get married, you stay in a marriage. You know, you have children, you feed your children until they get old enough. Verse 3. We're gonna get there. And when she could not longer hide him, talking about Moses, because they were killing the babies, he's 3 months old now. She took for him an ark. So she made a little chest out of bulrushes and daubed it with slime and with pitch, and put the child therein, and she laid it in the flags by the river's bank. The literal translation is she made the chest out of like papaya, like a, you know, it's like palm, like a branch. She made the chest, the little ark, and she placed it in the bank of the Nile River. You know, I'm sure the Nile River had crocodiles. You know, now, would the crocodiles eat him in that basket? They probably wouldn't see him in it. See, God knows how to cover you, to hide you. So she placed him in the Nile, and Pharaoh's daughter, verse 5, and the daughter of Pharaoh came down to wash herself at the river, and her maidens walked along by the riverside, and when she saw the ark among the flags, she sent her maids to fetch it. In other words, even if there was alligators or crocodiles, what do they have in the Nile? I don't know. Lizards. Whatever they were, this woman still took a bath there. So there was a place where she felt safe enough to take a bath, but there was an ark, a chest, something that has something treasurable on the inside, and it just happens to be Moses. That's why I said earlier, the deliverer is in the ark, and deliverance is in the ark. She opens up the chest. It's a little little Momo is in there, who would become Israel's deliverer. And so you see, God places you and me in a church, in the body of Christ, for protection. You know, I often, this may seem a little odd, I'm often amazed at how often God drops people's spirits, names into my heart. You know, when they're going through something or when they're making a decision, they go, you know, it's like Elijah and, was it Elisha and, what's his name? Naaman. I think it was Naaman. No, Gehazi. The prophet Elijah and his servant Gehazi. Gehazi went to do something, and the prophet said, "Where'd you go?" And Gehazi said, "I ain't going nowhere." And the prophet said, "Did not my heart go with you?" In other words, God places pastors in a position to know where people are. You know, at the middle of the night, 3 o'clock, 2 o'clock afternoon, drops a name in your heart, in your mind. You start to pray for them. God starts to show you what's going on, and you pray for them. It's protection. That's why your pastor, your church, is your ark. It is your protection. But when you decide you don't want that protection, you kind of leave yourself out there. You know, God still got you, but it's even better when others are aware that you're in trouble. Somebody said, "I know that's right." So Pharaoh's daughter took care of him. You know, in verse 9 it says this, and Pharaoh's daughter said unto her, this is Moses' little sister, Moses' big sister Miriam, "Take this child away, nurse it, and I will give thee wages." And the woman took the child and nursed it. In other words, because Moses, the deliverer, stayed in the ark, God was able to preserve him and pay and have Pharaoh pay Moses' mother to breastfeed him. You talk about God. See, God, he's got you. You're on a job. You're working. That's God. You live in a nation that has unemployment insurance. That's God. You have the welfare system. That's God. Everything, you know, all right, let's make it clear. The Bible says, talking about God, "Thou opening up thy hand and satisfies the desire of all living." If you're getting any help, it's coming from God. Somebody say amen. Yeah, say amen louder than that. So we see that God made Noah make an ark. Now he had Moses' mother make an ark for little Moses. And now God, in Exodus chapter 25, tells Moses that he wants an ark for himself. And in Exodus 25, verse 8, it says this, "And let them make me a sanctuary, that I may dwell among them." Verse 10, "And they shall make an ark." In other words, God said, "I want you to build an ark, a chest, a box for me, and I'm going to meet you at that box." And it was in the Holy of Holies. And verse 16 says this, "And thou shalt put into the ark the testimony which I shall give thee, and thou shalt make a mercy seat of pure gold. 2 cubits and a half shall be the length thereof, and 1.5 cubits the breadth thereof." In other words, there should be a seat, a cover, on top of this box. Inside the box is the testimony, the word of God. See, inside of your life is the word of God. And so he said there's a box and there's a seat. When I meet with you, I'm going to meet you over the mercy seat. So when God talks to you, talks to me, he never comes to judge us. He always comes to give us mercy. Because, you know, we're always guilty. We always did something wrong. And I grew up with 7 brothers. And, we listened to our parents. We listened to my father. We listened to my mother. If your father said don't go outside, you didn't go outside. Yeah, right. We went outside, we broke rules, we broke the house, we messed up, but we had a system. We knew what time he'd get off work. And when he got off work, we would look out the window and we see him walking, and we would tell everybody he's on his way. And man, we try to get the house fixed and run upstairs. We try to do everything. But he knew something would be wrong and there would be no one to save us. I remember one day, this was the craziest. We had a fish tank. And I don't know if you ever lived in a project, but a project was built to last forever. You know, when the projects was made, it was a bomb shelter. We used to have signs in the hallway, fallout shelter. In other words, the projects in New York City could survive a nuclear blast. Y'all, if anybody from the project remember them signs, it was up there, you know. But the floors were slate, you know, hard. So that's why we used to, you know, if anything fell on the floor, it broke, especially your head. And I remember we used to have tops, you know, the spinning tops. And I remember, you know, we're not supposed to play tops in the house. My father getting off work at 3 o'clock. One of my brothers had a top tied. They lost control. They didn't lose control. They did it. And he spun that top. It hit the floor. That thing bounced right into that big fish tank and broke the fish tank. So you cannot fix a fish tank by the time my father came to the house from work. So everybody got beat. So the moral of that story is, you know, there are some things you're not going to be able to fix when Jesus comes back. He's going to come like a thief in the night. That's why you need to live like he's coming today. Hallelujah. I still remember that. But anyhow, and this is what it says. Verse 21. And thou shalt put the mercy seat above the ark, and in the ark thou shalt put the testimony that I shall give thee. And there I will meet with thee, and I will commune with thee from above the mercy seat. God's going to always talk to you from a position of mercy. He doesn't want to judge you. Doesn't want to judge me. Thank God. Somebody say hallelujah. Now in Leviticus chapter 16, verse 2 says this. And the Lord said unto Moses, speak unto Aaron, thy brother, that he come not at all times into the holy place within the veil before the mercy seat, which is upon the ark, that he die not. For I will appear in the cloud upon the mercy seat. In other words, you know, God told, you know, this was before Jesus paid for the sins of the world. The blood of Jesus wasn't covering them. They were just being covered by the blood of bulls and goats. He told them, if he think he could just pop up in my presence at any time, tell him, no, he's sadly mistaken. I will kill him. See, sin in your life is actually Satan in your life. So imagine bringing Satan in God's presence. God's like, I'm going to kill him. And I'm going to kill everybody that brought him in here. Come on. My father and mother were strict when it came to our house. You wasn't bringing nobody in there. All right. You think you're going to heaven just because you died? You died wrong. You go to heaven when you fall asleep if you already died with Christ. You don't die to go to heaven. You don't die and go to heaven. When you receive Christ, you already died. You're born again. Your life is hid with Christ in God already in heaven. So don't think just because you die, you're going to heaven. You already know you're in heaven. The kingdom of God, the kingdom of God is at hand. The kingdom of heaven is within. Kingdom of heaven is within. The kingdom of God is at hand. All right. Verse 12. This is what he told him. Talking about the ark where God is. And he shall take a censer full of burning coals. And you shall take a censer full of burning coals of fire from off the altar before the Lord, and his hands full of sweet incense beaten small, and bring it within the veil. And he shall put the incense upon the fire before the Lord, that the cloud of the incense may cover the mercy seat that is upon the testimony that he died not. In other words, God said this, listen, I'm going to be in the dark. You better burn enough incense, enough smoke, so I don't see you. Come on. The glory of God kills. It purifies. See, how can I say this? When you're trying to create gold, it goes through a fire. It goes through a purification process. Because God has already purified us, that's why we don't die. That's why we can abide his presence. That's why we can lift up holy hands without wrath, without doubting. Come on. But a sinner cannot abide the presence of God. We got to move a little faster. I'm sorry, guys. Let's watch this. Now go to 1 Samuel chapter 5. This is kind of interesting. The children of Israel thought the ark was a magic box. They thought if they take the ark with them, God's going to honor them. No, God, it doesn't work like that. You know, like some people wear crosses, and that don't make you a Christian. That just means you got a cross. You know, you wear robes. You know, that don't mean anything. You know, people wear those clergy collars. You know, that don't mean anything. No, just so you know, this is not a clergy collar. This is a stylish Nehru or a Mandarin collar. I don't wear clergy collars. Certain other people wear them because it's symbolic. But God's not into symbols. God's here. I'm not saying that wearing a collar is wrong. You know, it's honorable. You know, many of them have earned the right to wear one. You know, but I didn't grow up wearing them, so I don't wear them. And I don't wear a lot of things, you know. And let me say this much. And I think this is where I'm going to get in trouble. I dress my age. I'm not into fashion, but I dress my age. You can dress like you 18 or whatever. Do your thing. But, you know, I don't like change. Fashion changes. So I dress my age. You know, God gave the priests outfits, instructions to wear. So you can, you know, biblically wear whatever you feel like you want to wear. You know, I just said that just in case you thought I was trying to say something negative about a collar. No, you know, they wear it because it's an honorable gesture that they've come up with. 1 Samuel 5 says this in verse 1. And the Philistines took the ark of God and brought it from Ebenezer unto Ashdod. When the Philistines took the ark of God, they brought it into the house of Dagon, their god, and set it by Dagon, which was a statue. They took the ark where God said, I'm going to dwell in, and they put it next to a statue. This is one of the greatest stories for all religious people to read. And when they of Ashdod arose early on the morrow or in the morning, behold, Dagon was falling upon his face to the earth before the ark of the Lord. And they took Dagon and put him in his place. See, when you don't serve God, you know, you gotta lift your God up, pick him up off his face, and place him back in his seat when you don't serve the real God. Verse 4, and when they arose early in the morning, early on the morrow morning, behold, Dagon was falling upon his face to the ground before the ark of the Lord, and in the head of Dagon, and both the palms of his hands were cut off upon the threshold. Only the stump of Dagon was left to him. You know, God was like this. You jokers don't understand. I'm the real God. They put him in next to some fake God, and God knocks him on the floor, cuts his head off, and cuts his hands off. See, the presence of God, the defense ark of God is going to protect you. God in your life has been cutting off the enemy. There are plans that people have for your demise. God has cut the head of that thing off. They wanted to touch you. God has cut their hands off. Come on. God, you know, the ark, the church, the body of Christ has been preserving you. Hallelujah. So, you know, and I got to keep going real quick. Now, you know the story in Acts chapter 22. they arrested Paul. They put him on a ship, an ark, right? And they're in a storm, and they see the ground, they see land, and people want to jump off the ship. And this is what Paul tells them, verse 31. Paul said to the centurion and to the soldiers, except these abide in the ship, you cannot be saved. See, there are people that want to abandon you, you know, but everybody has to stay together. Come on, help me. He told the centurion, except they abide in the ship, you shall not be saved. Everybody in the ark is important for the salvation, the saving of everyone. Imagine Noah's kids, you know, tired of being in the ark. And they say, you know what, Dad, we're out of here. They just jump off the ark. You know, it probably would have overwhelmed Noah. You know, who knows what would have happened. And many times we want to jump ship. We want to jump out the ark of safety. We want to leave the church. We just want to relax. We don't want to pray. We don't want to read. We don't want to go to Bible study. We don't want to go to prayer meetings. You know what? I just want to do me. It's not safe. Stay in the ark. Stay connected. Amen. Now look at this, because I'm forgive me because I'm rushing because I only have a certain amount of time. I like to finish. Somebody just laughed. But I'm telling you the truth. Look at this. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 13 says this. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. If we believe not, yet he abideth faithful, he cannot deny himself. So if you and I decide we want to leave church, leave family, leave job, leave, you know, whatever, God's not going to deny himself. Many times we think God co-signed our abandonment. No, it says this, yet he abideth, remains faithful, he cannot deny himself. You're not going to pull God into your shenanigans. You're not going to pull God into your scheme, into your plot. You're going to have a rude awakening one day. He's going to tell you, I never told you to do that. You did that because you wanted to do that. Look at your neighbor, slap him real hard and say, stay in the ark. Stay close to the things of God. Stay close to the word of God. Stay close to the church of God. Stay close to the body of Christ. Now we're going to start to close here. Jesus in John 15, verse 4, he says this, abide in me, and I in you, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine. No more can ye, except you abide in me. I am the vine, ye are the branches. He that abideth in me, and I in him, the same bringeth forth much fruit, for without me, ye can do nothing. Here we go, verse 6. Very hard. Receive it, though. If a man abide not in me, he is cast forth as a branch and is withered, and men gather them and cast them into the fire, and they are burned. Verse 7. If you abide in me, and my words abide in you, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. So you see, when people decide that they don't want to stay in Christ, it's not that the devil took them out. It's not that God got rid of them. They left on their own. They came on their own, they left on their own. Somebody said they came on their own and they left on their own. Jesus said, if you don't abide in me, if you don't stay in me, you're going to be like a branch that has to be cast out and into the fire. You know, it reminds me of the Laodicean church. He said, I'm going to spit you out of my mouth. And then he also says, I will not blot you out of the book of life. So there are some Christians that actually think that they have something on God. Like, God, you got to keep me and bring me into heaven. No, you got it wrong. Jesus said, if my words abide in you, and you abide in me, you shall have what you say. But if you decide you don't want to stay in me, I'm not going to force you. Come on. Nobody's going to heaven saying, you know, I didn't want to come here. I wanted to go and be with my friends in hell. Nobody is coming to heaven like this, forced. Do you hear me? So this is what he said, abide in me, and I in you. Verse 10, if you keep my commandments, you shall abide in my love, even as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. You know, Luke 19:5, and when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. There was a time in your life where God came to the place where you were lost. And he told you, look, you know, he called you by name, and he said, make haste, accept me as your Lord and Savior, because I have to come and abide at your house. Hallelujah. This house, this body, God said, I want to come and I want to abide there. Jesus, the scripture says, you know, my Father and I will come and make our abode with you. See, if you're saved, you're the house of God because you have the Holy Ghost, the Spirit of God. The Spirit of God makes, watch this, you as a child of God makes your body the house of God, but the Holy Ghost in your body makes it now the temple of God. The house and the temple because of your relationship in the presence of God inside of your body. And let's close at 1 John chapter 2, verse 26 to 28 says this. These things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. Now many of you are being seduced, not from the outside, but from the inside. Things are not going your way. You want to be like Sam, what's that dude? Paul, Saul, King Saul, you know, impatient. Or Sarah with Hagar, impatient. You're going to create an Ishmael, something that God didn't plan for you. 1 John 2, 26 says this, these things have I written unto you concerning them that seduce you. Watch this. But the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you, and you need not that any man teach you. But as the same anointing teaches you of all things, and is truth, and is no lie, and even as it has taught you, you shall abide in him. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and not be ashamed before him at his coming. You know, many times people are very, very unaware, or let me say it in a better way, not interested in being spiritual. See, the anointing, the Holy Ghost in your life is the presence of God in your life. And what happens is you and I have to get to a place and stay there where we live anointed. And God gives gifts of the Spirit to keep you freshly anointed. The term anoint means to be covered. You know, in they would anoint, thou anointest my head with oil. It's a covering. So God has given the church the spiritual gifts, charismata, the gifts of the Spirit, and one of them is speaking in the heavenly tongues. And when you speak in tongues, you actually build up your most holy faith, and that's where the anointing has a better chance of you not needing man to teach you. Without the anointing, you need men to teach you. Come on. Now listen. Let's clarify. Spirit, no spirit. When a pastor that's anointed is teaching you and you have the anointing, it's not the pastor, it's the anointing teaching you. Amen? But when you don't have the anointing, you don't want to hear what an anointed pastor or minister is actually saying. Verse 27, but the anointing which you have received of him abideth in you, and you need not that any man teach you, but the same anointing teaches you of all things. You see, it's not saying that people can't teach you. They can't teach you what the anointing can teach you. In verse 28 is where we're going to close. And now, little children, abide in him, that when he shall appear, we may have confidence and be not ashamed before him at his coming. So many people run the risk of being ashamed when the Lord comes, but not you. See, stand to your feet. You will not be ashamed when the Lord comes, because you're going to, after today, you're going to stay anointed. You're going to stay on fire. You're going to learn and get back into praying in the Holy Ghost. You're going to get back to fellowshipping with other believers. You're going to get back to going to Bible study, church services, wherever God is dispensing gifts of the Spirit, you're going to be a part of it. Can you say amen? Come on, stand to your feet and let me pray for you. Hallelujah. Come on, stand to your feet. Now, Father, in Jesus' name, I brought your word. I've shared what you have told me to share with them. May I have received as it is and what it is, the word of the living God. So those that are in a sin, I'm asking that you will be merciful and give them the grace to repent. Get them back into the ark of safety. So right now, those of you that are not right with God, not right with your church, not right with other believers, I want you to ask God to forgive you so that you don't be, so you don't continue out there thinking that you're fulfilling the will of God. It's never been the will of God for the church to be dispensed. So spend a few moments to tell God that you repent and that you want strength to get back to the house of God with the believers of God. And those of you that have stayed connected, I want you to thank God. Don't be proud, but begin to thank God that he allowed you to stay connected in the name of Jesus. So Father, I thank you for them returning and for them staying. I ask that you, by mercy, will cause a great revival to fall upon your people in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Somebody say, I receive it. Somebody say like you mean, say, I receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Hallelujah. I receive it as well. And I just want to say thank y'all for tuning in. And I believe, you know, whom the Son sets free is free indeed. I believe God has been merciful to us. I believe he desired to save you. Hallelujah. And he has done so. Amen. And before we close, I believe, you know, I believe in giving. I believe the scripture says he that winneth souls is wise, you know. And I believe if God has saved your soul, you need to give him a thank offering, a gift directly to God, not what you owe God, not an offering, you know, not an offering because you have extra money, but an offering saying, you know what, thank you for saving me. And those of you that worship God with tithes and with offerings, of course, continue to give, for God loves a cheerful giver. God has been faithful. He hasn't changed. So you and I need to remain faithful. And if you're going to give, you can sow, you know, those of you that have a phone, if you want, you can call our church and we can make arrangements, pick it up from you. Telephone number is 201-259-8814. Again, Love of Jesus Family Church of Jersey City. Our phone number is 201-259-8814. You can call and one of our ministers will come. We can pick it up for you. Or you can sow online at loveofjesusjc.org. That's one word, loveofjesusjc.org. That's our website. Click on the give button on the top and it'll take you to a secure donate page. Amen? Hallelujah. So I believe God, you know, he has already blessed you. So for me to say God's going to bless you for giving, that's an understatement. He has blessed you. Amen. And so, Father, as they prepare to give, I ask that you would open up the windows of heaven, pour out a blessing upon us that we have not room enough to receive. And also, Father, that you will cause men to give into our bosom, pressed down, shaking together, and running over. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Somebody say, God knows me. He knows me and he loves me. Listen, I will see you guys next week, Tuesday, at our Bible study. But until then, may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you, be gracious and kind to you all the days of your life. Say this for me. Say, I'm blessed. Say it like you mean. Say, I'm blessed and I can't be cursed because Jesus is Lord. Hallelujah.
My life was in his hands. He calls me his own.